In Yemen, Houthi forces of the Ansar Allah movement confirmed Wednesday the launching of 3 missiles against Israeli military installations. In the United Nations headquarters in New York, members of the United Nations Security Council met to discuss the situation in the Middle East. And on Wednesday, the Gabonese government claimed sovereignty over 3 islands in oil-rich waters before the International Court of Justice at The Hague. Hello and welcome to From the South. I'm Alejandra Garcia from Telesur Studios in Havana, Cuba. We begin with the news. In Yemen, Houthi forces of the Ansar Allah movement confirmed Wednesday the launching of 3 missiles against Israeli military installations. A Houthi movement spokesman stated that the intended targets were hit and expressed their support of Iran's attack against Israel as part of the Iranian nation's right to self-defense. Furthermore, the movement confirmed the launching of drones against military targets in the Israeli cities of Tel Aviv and Eilat. Since November 2023, Houthi forces launched attacks in the Red Sea against Israeli ships and those of their allies in solidarity with the Gaza Strip in the face of the aggression of the Zionist occupier.
The criminal Netanyahu continues his large and dangerous project, committing crimes and terrorism against the Palestinian and Lebanese people. The blood that is being shed is pure and innocent, and the Israeli criminal Netanyahu must be punished for it. If he does not stop these actions and crimes, the Islamic resistance and the axis of resistance will take it upon themselves to deter him from these terrorist actions.
A memorial ceremony was held in Yemen for martyred Hezbollah Secretary General Sayed Hassan Nasrallah. President Mahdi al-Mashad addressed several officials and citizens in the capital Sana'a and affirmed that the axis of resistance is united and will confront all conspiracies despite the immense pain caused by the assassination of the leader. The Yemeni government assured that Hassan Nasrallah was a leader loved by the majority of the Yemeni people and the Arab and Islamic peoples. For his part, the head of the Supreme Political Council pointed out that the response of Lebanon, Yemen and Iraq against the Israeli occupation was welcomed by the free peoples of the world.
The response that came from Lebanon, Yemen and Iraq to the enemy entity, and what we saw from Iran was a torrent of missiles that delighted all the free peoples of the world. The blood of the martyr, Commander Hassan Nasrallah, will sweep away the entity of the Zionist enemy.
The Islamic Republic of Iran carried out on Tuesday a retaliatory strike against Israeli military positions in the occupied Palestinian territories, an action that the Persian nation claims was entirely defensive and in response to the Zionist regime's terrorist acts inside Tehran and against Iranian-linked targets elsewhere. Our colleague Hisham Wanous with the details from Damascus, Syria.
Iran's Islamic Revolutionary Guards Corps claims that 90% of its Iranian-made hypersonic ballistic missiles, loaded with cluster warheads, hit 3 military bases and an Israeli intelligence command center, from where attacks against Hezbollah Secretary General Hassan Nasrallah and Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh were planned and carried out. An operation that Iran warns will be followed by much more forceful actions if the Israeli entity and its allies dare to respond.
The missiles fall on the Israeli military positions in Tel Aviv and other areas of the occupied territories. This action is the beginning of other painful blows by the resistance movement against the Zionist entity until it's forced to surrender and stop its crimes that have shed the blood of the inhabitants of Gaza and the inhabitants of Lebanon. Otherwise, the war will be long and the victory will be of the whole axis of resistance. Coordination is constant at all levels as we coordinate with Syria and Syria coordinates with Hezbollah, and I believe that the axis of resistance is at the best level of coordination among its members. and our joint action would lead to victory, as the enemy cannot divide us and cannot incite sedition in the axis of resistance, and its actions would only lead to its inevitable defeat.
The Iranian operation was also in response to Israeli crimes against the peoples of the Axis of Resistance. An offensive that hit only Israeli military sites, responsible for the death of defenseless civilians in Gaza, Lebanon, and Syria. The Israeli air aggression against Damascus in the early morning of the same day of the Iranian attack is a sign of the terrorist nature of the Zionist occupation entity.
All the victims of this Zionist aggression, both dead and wounded, were from the civilian population, including a girl, so that the Israeli attacks reach mainly residential areas, because these targeted areas are not military areas and should not be attacked by the Israeli occupation as much as it does in Gaza and Lebanon. We condemn this aggression, which we qualify as a terrorist act, because the Israeli occupation is a terrorist entity, which for almost a year has been murdering civilians in Gaza and is currently attacking civilians in Lebanon, and now it is attacking us.
Meanwhile, the Lebanese resistance fighters took advantage of the Iranian retaliatory action to intensify their attacks against the Zionist troops, like their brothers on the other fronts in Palestine, Yemen, and Iraq. Operations that they claim they will not stop before ending the Israeli war of extermination against Gaza and putting an end to the repeated aggressions of the Tel Aviv regime against the other peoples of the region.
Hisham Wannous, Telesur, Oriente Medio. Let's take a short break, but remember you can join us on TikTok at Telesur English, where you'll find news in different formats, news updates, and more. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Welcome back. The Supreme Leader of the Islamic Revolution, Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, said that if the United States and its European allies abandon the Middle East, conflicts and wars will disappear. The Iranian Supreme Leader indicated that after the withdrawal of the U.S., the states of the region will be able to govern themselves, respecting the sovereignty of the peoples and living together in peace. He also expressed his hope that Iran, with the cooperation of other nations, will be able to expel the interfering countries from the region. The U.S. and its Western allies have provided Israel with financial, logistical, and intelligence support since October 2023, when the occupying regime began a genocide against Palestine.
If the United States and some European countries leave the West Asian region, these conflicts and wars will undoubtedly disappear and the countries of the region will be able to live in peace with each other.
Following the escalation in tensions in the Middle East, the Venezuelan government has issued a communique in support of the Iranian nation's right to defend itself from the Israeli attacks on the region. The official document states, the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela is following in detail the recent events in the Middle East that have prompted an action by the Islamic Republic of Iran, invoking its right to legitimate self-defense, as set forth in Article 51 of the Charter of the United Nations in response to the threats and crimes against humanity committed by the Netanyahu regime against Palestine, Lebanon, and the Iranian people, including violations of their sovereignty and territorial integrity and the murder of innocent civilians, as well as political and military leaders of these countries. It follows the inaction shown by the United Nations Security Council, paralyzed by the veto exercised in a complicit manner by the United States of America, has prevented the aggressions from stopping, and Netanyahu non-compliance with international law, which continues to be the greatest threat to security in the region. It is urgent to stop the escalation of war by Israel in the entire region and to determine its responsibilities in the war crimes committed by its government. To conclude, the communique states, the Bolivarian government of Venezuela urges the international community to mobilize in order to restore legality and stop the genocide against the Palestinians Palestinian people and Lebanon, as well as the unbridled race to take control of the region by Israel and the United States of America, which has had serious consequences for international peace and stability. On Wednesday, the government of Nicaragua congratulates Iraq through a communique for its 92nd anniversary of independence. Through an official communique, the government of Nicaragua states, on behalf of the people and government of reconciliation and national unity of the Republic of Nicaragua, and on our own behalf, we are proud to convey our most sincere congratulations to you, your people and government, as we commemorate the 92nd anniversary of the proclamation of independence and the establishment of the Iraqi state. Finally, the communique states, on this memorable date, and on behalf of the people and government of reconciliation and national unity of the Republic of Nicaragua, we reiterate our unalterable will to continue strengthening our fraternal bonds of brotherhood, solidarity, and mutual cooperation. In the United Nations headquarters in New York, members of the United Nations Security Council met on Wednesday to discuss the situation in the Middle East. During the emergency meeting, United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres called for an end to the sickening cycle of escalation in the region, where tensions escalate between Israel, Iran, Lebanon, and Yemen, and as the Zionist regime continues its genocide in Palestine. In this context, Guterres stated that this deadly cycle of tit-for-tat violence must stop, adding that the raging fires in the Middle East are fast becoming an inferno. Furthermore, the Secretary General stressed that the safety and security of all United Nations personnel must be ensured and said the United Nations interim force in Lebanon will remain in position. In Mexico, President Claudia Sheinbaum informed she will continue the daily morning press conferences introduced by former head of state Andrés Manuel López Obrador. Precisely, Sheinbaum's first mañanera was dedicated to remember and condemned the massacre committed on October 2, 1968 in Tlatelolco Square against the student movement that demanded freedom and democracy.
Today, on the day of the first Mañanera morning conference, on the second stage of the fourth transformation, we are going to dedicate it to October the 2nd. Because October the 2nd cannot be forgotten. 56 years ago, in Tlatelolco Square, after a student movement which demanded freedom, which demanded democracy, freedom for political prisoners, one of the greatest atrocities in history that took place in Mexico in the second half of the 20th century was perpetrated. It was ordered by the then President of the Republic, Díaz Ordaz, Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces. The repression against students who, in freedom and asking for public dialogue that had been offered, were assassinated, imprisoned.
Argentina's public universities hold a massive demonstration on Wednesday, backed by unions and opposition parties, to protest sharp public spending cuts implemented by President Javier Milei. Despite a heavy police operation, thousands of people gathered around the Argentine Congress as part of a federal university march in defense of free, inclusive, and quality public education. Members of social trade unions and human rights organizations, students, teachers, and citizens in general arrived at the legislative seat from different parts of this city and the province of Buenos Aires, while other regions of the country held other demonstrations as well. We have a second short break coming up, but before, we invite you to visit our YouTube channel at Telesur English. There you'll be able to rewatch an interview, top stories, special broadcastings, and more. Hit the subscribe button and activate the notification bell to stay up to date on the world's most recent events. Final short break, don't go away.
Thank you.
Welcome back to From the South. In Afghanistan, authorities reported at least 13 people dead following recent floods that hit several regions of the country. The National Disaster Management Authority informed that during the intense rains of the last days, 16 people were injured in the fight the eight states of the country due to landslides. It also detailed that more than 100 houses were totally destroyed and more than 650 hectares of croplands were damaged. In this regard, emergency teams continue to carry out relief and rescue works for families affected by the national disaster. In Greece, authorities report the death of two people due to forest fires in the Corinthia region. The Civil Protection Department stated that more than 2,000 people were temporarily evacuated in 13 localities throughout the region. Around 570 firefighters are engaged in the firefighting operation using 160 trucks, 6 helicopters and 4 air tankers. The blaze is moving towards the south and east of the country and has so far consumed more than 6,400 hectares. The Bolivian government reported that forest fires have ravaged 7 million hectares of forestry and pasture after more than 3 months of fires. President Luis Arce decreed a national disaster situation due to the forest fires that are mainly affecting the Santa Cruz department. In this context, the government requested the approval of 2 credits of $325 million in the plurinational legislative assembly to face the flames. Authorities described the fires in Santa Cruz as the greatest environmental disaster experienced in this region. In China, there are at least 2 dead, 70 injured and 2 missing after Typhoon Krathon hits Taiwan Island. The island's authorities reported that at least 9,000 people were evacuated from 11 cities and counties as a precaution. The government canceled academic activities in the region to safeguard the integrity of civilians. It also deployed thousands of soldiers to assist in rescue operations. In this regard, commercial flights in the area were canceled, causing hundreds of passengers to be stranded at the Taiwan airport facilities. On Wednesday, the Gabonese government claimed sovereignty over 3 islands in oil-rich waters before the International Court of Justice at The Hague. This way, the Gabonese authorities argued they reached sovereignty of the islands by the already established 1974 Bara Convention. However, Equatorial Guinea disregards the claim, recognizing as legal the agreement sealed between French and Spanish colonial powers in 1900. Furthermore, Equatorial-Guinean officials assure Gabon invaded the islands in 1972, occupying them illegally ever since. As a result, both nations agreed on finding out an amicable solution, allowing the ICJ to decide whether a claim is valid to define the legal right over the disputed territory. The Gabonese representative expressed her view on the case.
It is therefore up to you, ladies and gentlemen of the court, to determine whether the Bata Agreement is binding on the parties. If it is, the die is cast. This treaty, which in our view is fully valid, resolves all the problems of sovereignty over the islands and the demarcation of borders.
The French National Assembly's Law Committee overwhelmingly rejected a motion for the impeachment of President Emmanuel Macron, tabled by La France Insoumise, which criticizes the head of state for not respecting the results of the legislative elections.
Ladies and gentlemen, 69 votes were cast and 69 votes were returned, giving a majority of 35 for 15 against 54. Thank you very much.
Christmas holidays have begun already in Venezuela and families start to enjoy the atmosphere of festivities in public areas full of light and music. Our correspondent Osvaldo Sayas with the details.
The Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela officially opened the Christmas holidays. Hence, the streets of Caracas were full in lights and joy.
Christmas is starting early. There are little children who want it to come quickly. When they see the little lights, they say, come on, let's go to Paseo de los Próceres. They see the little lights and they get happy. The child Jesus is coming.
At the Paseo de los Próceres in Caracas, families took advantage of the first Christmas day to take pictures and celebrate the spark that characterizes them, as they themselves say.
Well, Venezuelans always have an additional spark, so perhaps that's why they started earlier. Or we started earlier.
For the Venezuelan families, the early Christmas season represents a welcome event, which had been announced by President Nicolas Maduro in September.
Well, I didn't expect this. I expected this for November, but the president brought it forward. Everybody was thrilled, even the children. For me, it's the best thing, to enjoy these moments here with them, and for them, it is the best. They are happier than we are. It's all good, nice. The lights, all very nice. I like it. They are blue, and blue is my favorite color. Everything is fine.
The Christmas holidays bring lights and joy, and a greater economic dynamic that can be seen in the streets, according to the merchants themselves, who welcome the celebration.
I think it is excellent that it starts now in October. It would be three wonderful months. You can already see the decorations. This brings a lot of customers. The Christmas spirit brings a lot of customers. When Christmas starts, the excitement is good. People get excited about shopping. People get excited about going out with their families.
In some areas of the Venezuelan capital, the people enjoyed taking pictures, walking around and taking advantage of public spaces. In the neighborhood of Petar, people enjoyed live music.
We are very happy with this. It's beautiful here in Petar.
According to the people on the streets, the Christmas holidays, always valued by Venezuelan families, have only just begun.
Osvaldo Sayas, Telesur, Caracas, Venezuela.
We have come to the end of this news brief, but you can find these and many other stories on our website at telesurenglish.net and join us as well on social media. We are on Facebook, X, Instagram, Telegram, and TikTok. For Telesur English, I'm Alejandra Garcia. Thank you for watching.